Now we're looking at an area that you might recognize as ancient Greece, but we're at a time way before the Greek Empire ever began. And we know of at least three different cultures that were in this area. So I'm going to flip through these slides quickly, just showing you a little bit of what we're looking at in these cultures. Our first culture has to do with the Cyclades culture right here in the center. And they did not have a writing system, so there's not a lot we know about them. But they had these interesting figurines that were very abstract. Notice we have what we call a memory image. This looks like a human, even though it doesn't have a lot of human features to it. It's got a protrusion in the center of a round oval shape that we could call a face, and that looks like a nose. So already we're recognizing this human features. And notice how the feet are tilted. Yeah, they were designed to lay down in the grave sites. Again, they did not have a writing system, so we do not know the reason behind these, but they're very interesting abstracted figures that we labeled from a culture that we see in this area called the Cyclades culture. We also found a culture that we labeled the Minoan culture. Sir Arthur Evans, a very famous archaeologist, discovered the Great Palace of Knossos, and it was so confusing, the layout. This is just a reconstruction drawing of it, but the layout was so confusing and involved that he associated it with the a legend that originated about this time and about this period of, and a lot of people think it was the Greek culture that originated this a legend of the Minotaur. So, in of course, the legend of the Minotaur is about this half man, half bull that lives in a maze underneath a palace. And so it kind of fits with the story of the Minoans. And of course, the Minoans, nicknamed after King Minos, which was the legendary king in the story. So, Sir Arthur Evans had a lot of fun with this. This was a very sophisticated culture, what we call the Minoans. They had their own heating and cooling system to their palace, with these raised columns allowed the hot air and the smoke to leave the building and the cool breezes to come through. They had open staircases, and of course, these tapered columns are kind of amazing. They're made out of wood. They're actually upside down tree trunks, and they absorb shock better than stone. So there was a famous disaster that happened in this region that wiped out most of the Minoan society, which a lot of people think were the legendary Atlanteans. The coordinates and what Plato wrote about might not be, the accurate depiction of the history that happened, but there was a famous catastrophe that happened at this time, and it wiped out a lot of the Minoan culture. They had originated their territory on the island of Thera, this little half moon shaped island right here. At the very beginning, that was a round island with a volcano in the center. And when it erupted, it literally sucked the whole island down. These people were so advanced, they saw the warnings. They understood that something bad was going to happen. So they actually evacuated to the island of Crete, where they built the Palace of Knossos. Unfortunately, they did not evacuate far enough. This was their territory, their region, and a tsunami that was generated from the volcanic eruption caused a caught, of course, the volcano caused earthquakes underground, which caused the tsunami, and then wiped out a lot of the surviving Minoans on Crete. But they did build this incredible palace that we associate with the legend of the Minotaur. And it was like a maze. And we're not even sure, when you say palace, you think kings and queens. We're not even sure they had a king or a queen. Many people believe this was a matriarchal society. We see images of goddesses. This was made with a technique called faience, which is a glass glaze that they put over it to have her shimmer and sheen. Notice she's wearing one of the very first bodice, very first ideas of a bra. And she's commanding these snakes, like she's in control of them. She's not afraid of them. She's shaking them or directing them. We don't know, again, what this means. The Minoans did have a writing system, but two of the three writing systems that they had still have not been deciphered to this day. So a lot of their history remains a mystery to us, especially since they were wiped out from the catastrophe. You see, the main subject matter in many of their paintings and murals on their pottery is going to be, of course, sea life. They had a wonderful naval base. They did not attack other societies, but they did have a naval base that actually allowed them to defend their own island. However, that diminished too when this horrible catastrophe occurred. Beautiful. So this is known as one of the very first landscapes in history. It is a fresco. That's one of your key terms that you need to know. Painting on wet plaster. So they're using tempera paint, which is a water-based paint, and they're painting on wet plaster before it cures, which means before it dries completely from outside to inside. And if you paint on wet plaster, then when the plaster dries, it sucks up the paint and actually bonds with the plaster. So it's stronger than just a regular painting on a wall. It's part of the plaster. So you can see it's in very good condition considering how old it is. They had a lot of people believe this might have been a rites of passage from the Minoans. This must have been very important to their culture, but notice it's a man doing a backflip over a bull. There's a woman here waiting to catch him. Probably a rites of passage. They had a lot of images that talked kind of about that subject matter. Rites of passage, meaning teenagers into adulthood. There's a good close-up image of the tapered columns that Sir Arthur Evans and his team excavated at the Palace Knossos. And here's a plan view of it, how complicated this structure was. Now, the Minoans were experts at pottery. If you live on an island, you're not going to have a lot of farmland. So you need to find something that you can trade with other cultures. And for the Minoans, it was their pottery. So this was a very popular type of pottery that they sold. Look at this Rhynton, which is a very small vessel, and the beautiful raised surface on it, the harvester vase, with all this procession of men laughing and singing. Unlike some of the cultures that we looked at earlier with the ancient Sumerian culture with their conquest and their battles, here the major theme in the Minoan life is very happy. Must be some type of a harvest festival. But nonetheless, the original, you can see it had gold leaf, a very fine sheet of gold that you can, like gold foil that you can wrap over this and make it look like it was solid gold. Now, after the Minoans were just never really did build up their society again after that horrible catastrophe. And in this region, the next culture to rise are going to be the Mycenaeans. And the Mycenaeans predate the Greek culture and a lot of which will actually become in this territory the Greek culture. They were known for their beehive tombs. Yeah, they call them beehive. These are actually formally known as the Tholos tombs. the chevron upside down triangle here marking the door. And look at that incredible masonry work there at the top. Their entire city was built on an axial plan. Circled around the island. And they had one entrance to their city, the Lion's Gate here. Talk about your tough border patrol. Imagine soldiers on both sides and you trying to get your cart or your chariot through there. It must have been pretty tough. Eventually they did build a back door, but yeah, this was the only entrance to their city. They started out like the Minoans, very peaceful, but then became more warlike when they encountered a lot of unrest. And then of course we get one of the most famous death masks inside. It was found inside the Tholos tomb here. And at one time they were associating with the famous king who conquered Troy. Now, no, not so much. It's under debate because this type of mustache was not worn by men at this time. So, some people believe this artifact was tampered with. But nonetheless, this was over the face of a body. So it's a death mask. And of course, even Homer from the Iliad and the Odyssey, that Homer talked about the Mycenaeans and their incredible weaponry. Here we have all kinds of different metal smithing techniques here with the rivets. And then, of course, you have this incredible inscription on the inside inlaid with gold. It's bronze. And Nelio is the effect where they actually scratch into the metal and then put this black glaze in there, fire it in a kiln so it fuses with the metal, and you get your nice little detail work there. Here, chasing and repoussé, you have this black tar substance called pitch, and you shape it into these forms, and then you can hammer sheets of metal around it and shape it into this incredibly elaborate cup. That takes a lot of work and effort, working with a hammer and chisel to create these shapes, hammering over these bumps that create it to make cavities and reliefs that come out of the cup. So they were expert goldsmiths. And yeah, in the Mycenaean culture, much more warlike than the Minoans here. This is a funerary vase, a crater. The Greeks will continue this tradition with the craters. These are some grave markers. Some of these had holes in the bottom of them so they could pour offerings to the deceased person that the grave was marking. And of course, this here, unlike the Egyptians, which focused on the afterlife, here with the Aegean cultures and the Greek cultures, they focused on the people that were left behind after a funeral. This woman with her hand on her head is showing signs of grief as they go off to, as the soldiers go off to war. You can imagine battles back then. The soldiers, when they went off to war, they didn't come back. So the women knew this, so that's why they were grieving like they were already dead. The grieving that we see a lot in the art, in the Greek cultures, the women would literally rip the hair out of their heads, out of grief of seeing their husbands, their sons, and their fathers march off to war.